is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Good morning and welcome. We are grateful to have you here with us, worshiping with Hillier Memorial Christian Church this morning. If you are new to Hillier, whether this is your first time visiting us online, or perhaps if you've been worshiping with us for a little while, I want you to know that we would love to get to know you. If you are interested in learning more about Hillier, we invite you to shoot us an email at info@hillierchurch.org. We would love a chance to get to greet you, to learn how we might pray for and with you, and to share with you a little bit about what makes this community so special. If you're looking for a way to perhaps get a little bit more involved with the community of Hillier, I want to invite you to join us in our Women's Service Project for the month of November. Hillier's Disciple Women's Ministry are collecting gently used or new books for children, and we'll be donating them to St. Saviour's Diaper Train and to Interact. Both of these organizations have asked that if you're considering purchasing a new book, that you look for books that represent a diversity of people, particularly people of color, so that the children who receive the books can see people who look like them in the pages. If you're interested in participating in this service opportunity, you are welcome to drop books by Hillier's office at any point during the week in between now and November 22nd, when we'll be concluding our collection. If you have any questions, feel free to email us at info@hillierchurch.org. Today, we are continuing our annual stewardship campaign, enabling us to fund Hillier's mission and ministry into 2022. Our theme this year is Legacy of Love. And in this season, we're reflecting on the ways that we are heirs to the promise that God gave to Abraham, and the ways that we are called to pass on this legacy of love to both our children and to the world. I invite you to pray with me as we consider how each of us might support Hillier's ministries in this next year. You can make a pledge online at any time at hillierchurch.org/give, and you'll also have the option there to set up a reoccurring gift if that's something you would be interested in. If you're more comfortable with a paper pledge card, you can pick some up from the office and fill it out there as well. I want to invite you now to listen to one of Hillier's members as they share how Hillier has grown this legacy of love in their lives.
I started coming to Hillier right before my freshman year in high school, and that meant that I was in CYF with a whole group of kids that had been born in Hillier and had grown up going to Hillier. And so sometimes I felt a little left out, not because they intentionally did it, but because a lot of times they talked about memories they had that I wasn't around for. And there were some nights that I wasn't sure I wanted to keep coming to Hillier. But then I joined Celebrate Youth Choir, and Susan Gray welcomed me with open arms. And Lynn McCaney made sure that I never sat alone at snack supper. And Rob Morris made sure that I felt valued and that my opinion was heard. And so I kept coming, and I started to make memories of my own. I worked nursery with Carson Gombas, and so the first diapers I ever changed belonged to Aiden Gillespie and Elijah Gray. I started playing my flute at services, including one youth Sunday where the communion line took so long that I ended up switching songs halfway through because I was bored of playing the same thing over and over. And then the people in my memory started shifting. Instead of seeing Taryn Gillespie waist high holding Micah Power's hand because she was so scared of performing in front of people, she stood next to me and taller than me, not that it takes much to be taller than me, and we played flute duets at a Christmas tree lighting at Glenwood South. I became a youth sponsor, and suddenly it was me making sure that no kid sat alone at snack supper. And Elijah Gray held my own baby in diapers in my own kitchen, but he somehow got out of changing them. And that's the wonderful thing about Hillier, is that I know that there's still so many more memories to come. I look forward to the one day that Eleanor is packaging sausage biscuits before a Christmas parade and asks why it's called Miss Polly's Kitchen. And I can tell her about snack suppers and community chorus receptions and cutting the crusts off of cucumber sandwiches with the electric knife because it made the edges look neater. I look forward to watching the youth that I've had the honor and privilege of sponsoring become adults in their own right and maybe one day start bringing their own kids. And that's what Hillier's legacy is all about. It's a legacy of those happy memories. A legacy of the family, the one that we were born into, and the one that we choose to be a part of. And a legacy that, of a love that knows no bounds because it's both earthly and divine. That's why Hillier is a legacy of love.
Good morning, Hillier. Let us pray. Holy God, when we come before you, we cannot help but give you thanks. We thank you, Lord, for the ability to gather today. We thank you for creating the world and calling it good. We thank you for sending your Son, Jesus Christ, to reconcile us to you. We thank you for giving us the Holy Spirit who dwells in our hearts. Lord, we ask for you to hear our prayer. Help us to trust in you and to feel your presence in new and old ways, especially when we feel ourselves wandering in what seems like a desert without an oasis in sight. When we do not know where the path leads, Lord, help us to take each and every step. We have seen your faithfulness to Abram and Sarai when you called them into the desert. We have seen your faithfulness to the Israelites wandering in the wilderness. And Lord, we see your faithfulness to us today as we experience deserts of our own kind. We pray for those here and afar who feel like they are wandering in the desert, whether because of hardship or affliction or worry or fear. You, Lord, are our living water in the desert. With joy, we draw water from the wells of salvation, and with wonder, we worship your name because you are with us wherever we go. We give you all the praise and glory, and we pray all of this in Jesus' mighty, precious, and powerful name. Amen.
Our scripture reading today comes from Genesis chapter 12, as told by Sonia Stewart and Jerome Berryman in the curriculum we use for children's worship and wonder. This is the desert box. So many important things happened in the desert that we just had to have a piece of it in our room. The desert is a strange and wild place. At night, the desert gets very, very cold. But during the day, it's burning hot. There is almost no water at all. The desert is always changing. The wind blows, and as it blows, it shapes and it molds the desert so that the desert is never the same. Once Abram and Sarai lived in the beautiful city of Haran. The one true God loved them. And one day, God said to them, "Move from your home. I will give you a new home and a new land. It's all right to go. I will be with you, and I will bless you, and I will make you a blessing." Abram and Sarai looked across the desert. It would be sad to leave their family and their friends. They wondered if it would be safe. Would God still be with them? Abram and Sarai went. They trusted in the one true God to show them the way. They came to the city of Shechem in the land of Canaan. God had been with them in Haran. Would God be with them in Shechem too? Then God said to them, "Look at the land. I will give this land to your children." Abram and Sarai were so happy that they couldn't help but give thanks to God. And so they built a special place, a place called an altar. And they prayed their thanks to God. From there, Abram and Sarai moved on to a place near Bethel. And God was with them there too. Abram and Sarai were so happy that God was with them that they could not help but give thanks to God. And so they built an altar. And they prayed their thanks to God. Then there was a great famine in the land, and there was not enough food. They were so hungry. And so they went to the land of Egypt for food. Abram was scared. He was scared of the people in Egypt. He forgot that God promised to be with them. But God did not forget. God kept Abram and Sarai safe. And the people in Egypt were good to them. They gave them animals and food. And after a while, Abram and Sarai went back to the land of Canaan, the land that God promised to give them, to a city called Hebron. Abram and Sarai wondered. God had been with them in Haran and in Shechem and near Bethel and in Egypt. Would God be with them in Hebron too? Then God said to them, "I will give you many children to live in this land." Abram and Sarai were so happy that God was with them that they could not help but give thanks to God. And so they built an altar. And they prayed their thanks to the one true God who was with them. Now Abram and Sarai knew that the one true God who spoke to them and who showed them the way was with them in every place and at all times, just as God had promised. This is the word of God for us, the people of God. Thanks be to God.
I was a reluctant hiker. Some of you might think of me as an outdoorsy type, somebody who's always keen for a new adventure in the wilderness. But the truth is, I did not grow up in a camping family. We enjoyed some limited time in nature, preferably nature walks with broad, flat terrain and fairly near a real bathroom. And so it wasn't until college when I was dragged multiple times to various wilderness adventures with friends and programs with school that I actually began to learn how to navigate in a space outside the confines of the city and began through those experiences to actually enjoy it. On some of these forays into the wilderness, there were times now and then where we would pass a stack of rocks. Looked definitely human-made, but just sort of sitting there off to the side of the trail. And I never really paid much attention to them until one week when I was hiking with a friend who was both at home in the wilderness and a natural teacher. And so when we passed one of these, she paused and asked, "Do you know what these are?" "No," I told her. And so she shared with me, "These are Karens." "Karens?" I asked. And all I could imagine was this pile of rocks next to a picture of my aunt's face. And she goes, "Yes, well, no. Karens as in C-A-I-R-N-S. Karens," she explained to me, "are human-made piles of rock. And they're put on the trail, sometimes to suggest to other hikers which way to go, perhaps at the fork in a trail, and at other times placed there as a memorial, indicating something important happened there." The Bible doesn't say this, but I wonder if Abram was not a natural born hiker either. He may have even been a homebody, pleased to live in the city of Ur, where he was born, for the rest of his life. But as so often happens, Abram's father, Terah, had to relocate. Perhaps business was booming in Canaan, and corporate needed somebody to be there on the ground. For whatever reason, Abram moved with his family, and although they never made it all the way to Canaan, they settled in the city of Haran. It wasn't Ur, but it was a good place to set down some roots and to build a life with his wife, Sarai. Except that God had other plans. One day, God called to Abram and told him to leave his home and his family and to go to the place I will show you. No destination. Abram wasn't even given a map, just a summons to go and a promise that God would bless him. And so Abram, who doesn't get called Abraham for a few chapters yet, leaves with his wife Sarai and moves to Canaan. And God shows up, first in Shechem, then near Bethel, in Egypt, even when Abram forgets that God is the one in control. Abram discovers that even then, God continues to care for and to protect himself and his wife. The worship and wonder story we heard today does a great job highlighting how in each place in the land of Canaan where Abraham went, he built an altar. A memorial to a place where he had encountered God, remembering a moment when God had showed up in his life in a real place. A moment when God had showed up in his life in a real way. I imagine that many of us have a story or two from our own lives where God has showed up in a real way. Perhaps it was in the unexpected gift that came right before the account was about to be overdrawn. Maybe it was in the job offer or the house sale that came just at the right moment. Or in the friend who shows up to wash the dishes and clean the bathroom, or just to sit in those long hours in the waiting room. I wonder how you remember those moments when God has showed up for you in a real way in your life. I have to admit that that's not something that I'm particularly good at. And I find at least a little bit of comfort knowing that I'm not the only one. Even the Israelites who walked through the sea on dry ground, who were fed the wonder bread of God in the wilderness, struggled to remember that God had been with them. So much so that we end up with psalm after psalm in our scriptures, recounting the history of how God had been present for the people, because they needed help remembering. If your memory is anything like mine, or like the Israelites, sometimes we need that help remembering to remember. If you're a writer, one of the ways that can happen is by taking some time to journal and writing all the vivid details, painting the scene of how God showed up in your life. If writing's not for you, even just some bullet points in a notebook next to your bed may be enough to jog your memory, reminding you of a moment you encountered God. Some of us have the gift of friends and family who have journeyed with us through enough of life that when we forget, they can remind us about that time when God was made real. But I think there's also something about having a physical, tangible reminder, perhaps one that we pass every day or every week. I think about the butterfly that rests on the side of our building in the garden next to the church. Each time we pass it, We have an opportunity to remember Rowena and the ways that she served as the hands and feet of God to so many in our congregation. For my family, cardinals are that reminder. I asked my sister this week if I could share our story, because really it started as her story. When we moved in the middle of high school for me, middle school for my sister, we were looking for a new house. And Christine prayed and asked God to send a cardinal to the house that was supposed to be ours. Well, at one house, a cardinal showed up. And that was the house that became our home and turned out to be so much of a better fit for us than we could have even imagined when we first saw it. And now, every time I see a cardinal, I think about the way that God showed up for our family in that particular moment. I heard a story once, and I can't remember where, otherwise I would share it with you. But it was a story of a woman who picked up a stone for every important life event that happened to her. She had a stone from the beach where her husband proposed to her, a stone from the cemetery where she buried her father, a stone outside the very first place she worked as an adult, and from the hospital parking lot, the day she brought home her firstborn daughter. She kept all of the stones in a glass jar sitting next to the sink. And when her daughter was older, one of her favorite things to do was to bring down the jar, spill out all of the stones, and listen to the stories that each stone helped recall. Having such a tangible reminder on display reminds not only us of the ways that God has been at work in our lives, but it creates an opportunity to share with others about how God has been present in our lives. Other people get to hear ways that God has been working in the world. And as we retell the story, any good teacher will tell you that it helps us learn it better too. Abram remembered by lifting one stone on top of the other. That was his tangible, visible sign. The stones he chose weren't cut or polished. They were simply the stones he found in his travels, and he had to work to make them fit together just right. An old man in the wilderness, laying stone upon stone, scattering altars as he traveled through a land not yet his own, following the promise of a God he could not see. And here's the thing about these altars. They tend to stick around. Years later, when the son God promised to Abram was all grown up, God appeared to Isaac and made it clear that the promise God made to Abraham was extended to Isaac as well. And do you know what Isaac did when he received this promise from God for himself? He built an altar. Because he had learned that when God shows up in a real way, you build an altar and pray your thanks to God. Years after this, Isaac's son Jacob encounters God in the city of Bethel. And God promises once again to this child of Abraham that the promise is for him too, that God will be with him wherever he goes. And in response, Jacob sets up a stone in memory. If you remember from our story, Abram once set up an altar just outside of Bethel. And I can't help but wonder if Jacob passed that the day before his own encounter with God. Did seeing that altar remind him that he served a God who speaks, a God who shows the people the way? I wonder if that made him ready for his own encounter with God. Abraham's children build altars. The Apostle Paul reminds us that we are children of Abraham and heirs to the promise that God made with Abraham and Sarai, with Isaac and Rebekah, with Jacob, Rachel, and Leah. Their altars beckon us to build our own altars, to mark for ourselves and our descendants moments in time, places where God has showed up for us in a very real way. These piles of stones don't mark anything that we have achieved. And they, surprisingly, don't signify a fulfillment of what God had promised. Rather, the stones that we leave behind speak of a moment when God was made real to us. When I take friends home with me to visit Boston, one of my favorite places to take them is a place called Halibut Point on the very northern tip of Cape Ann. On a clear day, you can look back at the New England coastline and see all the way up into Maine. To get out to the point, you follow a wooded trail. You circle around an old quarry that's now filled with water until you reach the ocean, which is kept back from the shore by some of the largest rocks I had ever encountered. There's this one part along the way, a flat area in the shelter of a cliff, and it is filled with Karens. The area is crowded now, but I like to imagine what it was like when the first person came, knelt on the rocky ground, and decided to build a Karen. I think the second Karen came more easily, and then the third. It's almost as if one person's pile of rocks compelled later visitors to build their own. Each new Karen, both a response and an invitation. I've still never built a Karen of my own. But now that I know what they mean, I'm compelled as I pass to add my own stone to the pile.
Oh, gently lay your head upon my chest, and I will comfort you like a mother while you rest. The tide can change so fast that I will stay the same through the past, the same in the future, the same.
Brothers and sisters, we are invited to the Lord's table today. As God was with Abram and Sarai in Haran and near Bethel and in Egypt and in Hebron, God is with us here today in Raleigh. And God is in California, and God is in Mexico. And God is with the people in Ireland and South Sudan and Nepal. God is with us here, and his spirit dwells in our hearts. The one true God is not bound to any space or time, but God is in all places, and God exists throughout all ages. As Abram and Sarai built an altar to the Lord, we too have an altar here which is found throughout the world. And at this altar, we can gather as the body of Christ to remember what Jesus has done for us. So brothers and sisters, come to the altar today.
Let us pray. Good and loving God, as we come to your table, we offer our thanks for the grace and mercy available to us. Give us the strength to appreciate each day and to reflect the teachings of your Son, Jesus. We invite you to inhabit our hearts now as we come to the communion table. Remind us, God, that you feed our souls and nourish our hearts. Please bless this bread and cup representing the broken body and shared blood of Jesus, that we may understand the grace and forgiveness that is ours through Jesus' sacrifice. As we share this meal together as one family filled with your love, we remember that all we have needed, your hand has provided. In Christ's holy name we pray. Amen.
And so at this altar, we remember the story. How that night, Jesus took his place at the table. And with his disciples around him, he took the bread, blessed it, and broke it, giving it to his disciples to eat and saying, "This is my body, which has been given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, Jesus took the cup, gave thanks for it, and gave it to his disciples to drink, saying, "This cup, which has been poured out for you and for many, is the new covenant in my blood for the forgiveness of sins." Brothers and sisters, whenever we eat this bread and drink this cup, we are proclaiming the Lord's death until he comes again. Brothers and sisters, wherever we are worshiping today, let us pray the Lord's Prayer together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
God, from whom all blessings flow. Praise him, all creatures here below. Praise him above, ye heavenly hosts. Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost.
as you go forth from this place into a new week of life. Carry with you the love of God, the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit until we are gathered around God's table together once again. Amen. Thank you, friends. Remember, as you leave, to take a moment to share this service on your page, or perhaps to share it directly with someone you know needs to hear this message this morning. Don't forget to consider donating a new or gently used book to support our women's ministry, St. Savior's Diaper Change, Diaper Train, and Interact. Be sure to let us know if there's anything we can be in prayer about for you this week. Take care and go in peace.